everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of Sports Talk on Leominster Television. I'm Jeff Sylvia.
And I'm Aaron Bolio, and week three in the NFL season is through, and 2016 is already proving to be a very unpredictable and hard-to-read year, just as always. This week definitely personified that with all sorts of crazy upsets, all sorts of newcomers trying to take the throne from the old guard, and all sorts of new injuries to sort through. So we're going to sort through some of the big upsets, some of the surprise teams, and talk first about the new rookie in town, Jacoby Brissett, who had a pretty impressive start. I mean, This was a game I wasn't looking the most forward to break. It was a game I loved watching, not a game I was looking very forward to breaking down, because it's really hard to find anywhere that the Patriots did wrong in this game. I hate covering these perfect games, because there's not really much to say. They beat them in every phase of the game. That's the only way I can put it.
They sure did. Three different quarterbacks, and now three wins for the Patriots. Of course, Bill Belichick now 6-0 with rookie quarterbacks. You have to just love the guy. You have to love the system. You have to love what a complete game that the New England Patriots did put together on Thursday night. Again, beating them in every single phase of the game. It was 1 minute left in the third quarter when they finally passed the 50-yard line. So say what you want about McDaniels, Belichick, and the New England offense, but that defense also showed up as well.
I think the biggest thing was coaching. The Texans got completely out-coached. I hated a lot of decisions they made. They were very, very conservative a lot of the game. They played kind of timid for the most part, and it was just ridiculous how they were basically out-strategized. And I think that's a big thing. We can talk a little bit more about this, the coaching aspect, going when we talk about the upcoming game against Buffalo. But only two coaches have ever beaten the Patriots in Gillette Stadium in the playoffs, and that's John Harbaugh's Ravens doing it twice, and Rex Ryan's Jets. And the two things that those two coaches have in common that I think most other coaches don't bring when they come in here, they have the right level of confidence in their own scheme. They have the right level of confidence in their team. They believe in themselves. They get them hyped up to do what they need to do. They don't overthink. They don't underthink. And I think a lot of times you'll see one of two possibilities. You'll get when a team comes into Gillette, you'll get the coaches that are timid. They're afraid of Bill Belichick. They feel like they need to outthink him or outdo him, and you're not gonna succeed in outthinking him.
Right.
I've seen
especially
so many teams come in here. They think they're gonna do some kind of cheeky play calls, some kind of weird trick plays and fakes. And I think the only time I've ever seen a team come into Gillette with a weird game plan in mind, like a unique, nobody thought of it, and having it work was Sperano and the Wildcat with the Dolphins back in 08. That's the only time I can ever remember anybody coming in here with a new, fancy, I'm going to outthink Bill Belichick game plan at work.
And of course, taking him by surprise.
And, of course, it fell. And then you get what we saw from Bill O'Brien last night, where they're afraid of taking risks. They're afraid of attacking the Patriots on either side of the ball. They play way too conservative, and then this is what happens. They roll over them. And I think it's a lesson. It's a lesson to be learned about you really need to have confidence in your own team. If you feel like you have to try and outplay or try and play it safe, you're not going to win.
Well, the biggest thing that I take away from this game was the takeaways, and the Patriots defense did an unbelievable job of getting turnovers and forcing turnovers at critical times when there could have been a little bit of momentum starting for the Texans. It was just stifled by that Patriots defense. Can't say much enough about everything they did in all facets of the game. They gave him no room to run. This guy here was the only guy that could catch the ball
a couple of times on
the sidelines. But outside of that, they had nothing. Osweiler had no time back there to do anything. And we're looking at the pick now from Collins. Again, he was so rattled back there and so out of his element. Got to hand it to Belichick in that defense.
And it was a perfect game plan, too. Something they pointed out immediately during it was the Texans' biggest threat is the deep ball, because DeAndre Hopkins is one of the best deep ball receivers in the league right now. And so how the Patriots attacked, they attacked it very differently than Kansas City did last week. They decided they had the safeties out. They played a lot of cover, too. They tried to guard the sidelines deep. That's what they did most of the game. And the only big plays you saw from the Texans were those to DeAndre Hopkins, which weren't any more than about 10 or 11 yards. to the outside. That's the one spot that they would let him let them hit it, and they wouldn't even let him hit it all the time. Also, a big credit to Jamie Collins, who I think completely shut down Lamar Miller in the run game. That I mean, Texans, I think, had some decent runs out first, but after that, it was just completely clogged up, which, once again, kind of goes into I don't know why the Texans decided that they wanted to continue to run the ball at that point. But speaking of running the ball, that's what the Patriots, I think, did especially good. And that's why I think Skarnecchia, returning as the offensive line coach, unsung hero, I think, of the first 3 weeks. The offensive line has looked fantastic, and the holes that LeGarrette Blount has been getting these first 3 weeks, this is the best he's run since he's come to this team. I've never seen him have such clear, open holes to run through, except against the Colts. They're the only team I've ever seen them bully like this. And this was a team with J.J. Watt and Vince Wilfork.
And you didn't hear J.J. Watt's name hardly called at all. And we'll get into the injury here in just a little bit. But, you know, that running game with LeGarrette Blount is right now unstoppable. And you can't say enough about that offensive line, because this Patriots team is going to go as far as this offensive, this healthy offensive line for the most part now can take them. And, you know, with Tom Brady coming back here in a couple of weeks, their running game is right now carrying this team, setting up the pass
and you can
for
see right
these
there,
quarterbacks.
You saw right there was Julian Edelman had a fantastic block. It wasn't just the line.
It's
the
everybody.
Receivers had great blocks,
and that's
too.
That is typical of a Bill Belichick team in a Josh McDaniels offense. Everybody blocks downfield like no other team in the league, and this is the result of it. You got
this
250-pound guy breaking
and
away.
And this should be encouraging, because this is why they lost to the Broncos in the AFC Championship game. The offensive line was atrocious that game. They kept saying Brian Storck kept giving away the snap count. Von Miller and DeMarcus Ware basically had a field day. And yet they still had a chance to tie the game up with almost no time left. And really, a Gostkowski kick was the big difference in that game. They probably could have done a lot more on offense back in January against the Broncos if the offensive line looked anything like this. And really, the personnel have not really changed. As a matter of fact, I think – personnel-wise, they might have gotten worse with Stork leaving for Washington. So it looks good. My only concern with the Patriots this game, which I'm not going to have as a long-term concern, but Rob Gronkowski, I had him – actually, I played you this week in fantasy, and I kind of destroyed you because you left Amir Abdullah. But,
yeah.
You know.
And I started Carson Palmer, for God's sakes. We'll
but Rob Gronkowski got me 0 points, and that's because he was non-factor in this game. I don't think he claimed he was healthy. He claimed he was ready to go. He didn't do anything. Blocking, catching,
I'm not convinced
anything.
He's healthy. There's no chance that I'm convinced he's healthy. And certainly not even running on 80%. They're going to need him going down the stretch. And do you rest him at this time of the season so he can be healthy in the playoffs when you need him most? I mean, that's really the question. They have plenty of healthy bodies there at tight end that are playing very well.
The offense has been plenty productive without him so far. I'd save him. I'd save him for as long as he needs to. But I think he's trying to integrate back in too. As you know, like we talked last week about how he went to a non-padded practice with his pads on, and he basically told the media like, well, "I need to, you know, kind of integrate back into it." I think he's trying to integrate back in the game speed too, just being, you know, in the atmosphere, the, you know, being in the huddle, being against an actual opponent that's ready to hit you. It's a lot different than practice, and I think he's trying to slowly inch back in there.
Of course, you know, the injury reports coming out of New England are always been as tightly lipped as any government agency, or Fort Knox for that matter. So who knows the extent of the Gronkowski injury? And, of course, hamstring is not an injury. It's a plaguing injury. It's not anything that is easy to come back from, because it's something that can be re-injured very, very easily.
And someone who didn't need Gronkowski, we could talk a little bit about Jacoby Brissett, even though I don't think we'll be seeing him again anytime soon. I think the kid had a pretty impressive outing. I you know, in the Miami game, he was thrown in. They didn't want to risk anything. It was kind of light. I think he still is trying to work on the chemistry with the first-teamers. Edelman had a couple drops that were a little bit rough, and I'm not sure if it was just because he had a bad connection, but the kid's actually good on his feet, which is something we haven't seen in the – I can't even remember the last time you can think of a Patriots quarterback that could run. Maybe,
fleet of foot.
Maybe fucking Krogan or something way back in the day, if you want to go that far. But actually, as a matter of fact, Some of the design runs.
Grogan was never that fleet of foot. He ran the naked bootleg, but that's because there was nobody around him. It was like, hold on, and let's hope he makes it to the end zone. But one thing I will say about Jacoby Brissett was poise. Not really what you'd expect a poise level from a rookie quarterback making his first NFL start in such a big game for the New England Patriots with such big shoes to fill. That, to me, was the biggest striking factor about Jacoby Brissett, is how poised he was back there, running that offense, finding that rhythm, stepping up when he needed to, you know, and sprinting forward and gaining yards, you know, like no other quarterback New England's seen in quite a while.
Him and Jimmy both really looked poised in their first couple starts. They didn't look nervous at all, especially when you consider the shoes that they're filling with Brady. I kind of laughed when I watched some of the design runs, because I thought to myself, I was like, well, I wonder if McDaniels drew these up in Denver when he drafted Tebow and he was mad he never got to use them. That was my only thought when I saw them.
But, you know, question is, why, you know, understandably, the kid's got skills running the football. He's got good legs, but if he's your only guy out there, you know, if he's the lone soldier in that position and you got Julian Edelman as your backup quarterback, is it really a wise thing to send him out running the way they did?
I
know my heart skipped a couple of beats.
He slid quite a bit. I think he felt comfortable with it. He also wasn't really running hard.
He was probably in a very short leash with that.
Yeah, I think he was on a short leash because, you know, you see guys like Cam Newton, like when they run, they try and run people over. With Jacoby, he didn't try to do that. He tried to avoid people. He slid whenever he could. So I think they told him to be cautious if they were going to send him out to run. The last thing I want to talk about in this game, and we can kind of talk about it in terms of like what's going to happen next year and stuff. The special teams looked fantastic. You know, two fumbles, obviously, but Ryan Allen, the hang time was amazing. He just pinned it between the 10 and the 20 every time. It was just the perfect field position battle. But the big controversy this year is the rule change, where the touchback now goes to 25. And we've been seeing Bill take advantage of it because he has a very good kicker. And we've seen a lot of teams that have good, accurate kickers have been kicking it right on
the
goal line.
Just on the cusp.
Make them come out, and it just becomes a field position battle. So the NFL, their intentions have backfired. Do you see this rule? What are your thoughts about the rule change so far, and do you see this continuing onward?
I'm going on record right here, right now. I like that facet of the game, and I like that facet of the game because of the skill required. You know, over the last couple of years, it's just been boring to watch the kickoff. It booms into the end zone. They take it at the 20. That's usually the time you go up and grab a wobbly pop or some chicken wings because you know nothing's going to happen. Now, you sit there and you look for that placed kick that's going to either create a run back or maybe wreak havoc. And a guy like Gostkowski, perfect for that. I love the rule change and maybe a little bit more penalizing for the kick through the end zone because, you know, you can only watch that for so long. I mean, yeah, this guy, boom, he booms it through the uprights again. That's fantastic. And sure, now if we want to get kickers out there that are you know, going to be tested for steroids soon and kicking 70-yard field goals, sure. But I like the accuracy game. I like the finesse part of the game. And I love the fact that teams are now buying into this new rule and making some strategy changes because of it. I think it's a lot of fun to watch.
I love it. I love it myself. Because of the strategy, the strategy that it adds, I think it's great for the game. Because you're right, you know, those past couple of years we've been watching the kickoffs go straight out of bounds, and now with this, you know, this is the value of the kicker goes up again because now you want a kicker that can kick the 15-yard extra point, you know, the 30-yard extra point, and you want a kicker that's accurate. And then there's a whole other element too where say you're playing the Ravens or the Steelers and you have Devin Hester or Antonio Brown, like two of the best return men in the game. Do you take the risk and do it? You know, that's the kind of thing people are going to talk about. And as all things that are wonderful and great, the NFL is going to get rid of it. They are completely going to get rid of it. I think they're going to get rid of it at the end of the year because it completely backfired on what their intention was. They did this thinking there would be less returns. There's only been more returns. And I think they're going to scrap this as a failed experiment as soon as the year ends.
Well, the mindset of special teams is to pin them behind the 20. So if you are kicking off, you know, now you have that 5-yard cushion in your own mind. If you stop them around the 20, 25-yard line, it's now a success where years ago, you really had to stop them before the 20 to consider it a success.
Oh, yeah. And so that's, I mean, they made the rule thinking, oh, people are going to take the touchback more because it's 5 extra yards. Instead, people are kickers are placing it where they have to take it out, and it's caused more of it.
I want to see more of it. I love it.
And, you know, I haven't seen any evidence to indicate that that's the most dangerous part of football. I know there's been a lot of controversy about whether they should take it out or not. I haven't seen too many injuries. Like, I haven't seen any more injuries on a kickoff than I've seen on any
punt
other play.
You can't take away the kickoff. You can't take away the punt return.
And then what's going to be the onside kick if you take away a kickoff?
But it is like getting in a car accident every single time it happens because, you know, you got 300-pound guys running full speed at each other, full of pads and full of vigor. And, yeah, I mean, you watch some of the collisions these guys take. Look at Julian Edelman on any given day just going out over the middle.
That's why they don't
put him back there anymore because, you know, the body can only take so much beating. And these guys that are flying up the field like that, they eventually got to get to the next level. And that next level, you know, it usually starts with the smaller guys. But when you get through a couple of levels there, there's usually big guys that are behind that could certainly hit you and ruin your day.
Yep. All right. So, as usual, we go through all the games that happened the prior week. But I decided we should mix it up because there were some very interesting upsets, some very interesting teams in the first 3 weeks.
Boy, surprising.
And I don't know what to call this segment because, I mean, I think it's – I can't remember what show has it right now, but it's basically buyers and sellers. But I'm not going to call it that because I got another show that's called it.
Are we buying in or
– Even though every – program that has ever covered any sport, any team.
Smash or trash? How's that?
Smash or trash? Fine. Smash or trash?
Smash or trash?
All right. So we're going to look through some of the teams that kind of caught my eye, had some interesting wins, interesting starts to the year. And so I'm going to ask you, Jeff, Bills, smash or trash? Buying in? What do you think? Do you think they're for real after their win against the Cardinals? 33-18 was the final of that game.
You know, the hard part I have about this, Aaron, is that I don't know if the Bills were just that good or the Cardinals just laid that big an egg because Carson Palmer had a dreadful, dreadful game. And I'm knowing that because, of course, I had him on my starting quarterback playing you in fantasy football. But, you know, are the Bills really that good? I'm not sold on that yet. They still have, you know, Rex Ryan at the helm, which we'll get into later. And they still have to play the Patriots this week. This is the first win for them. You know, against a team that could be considered a caliber team, I'm not bought into them yet.
This is a combination of, for me, I'm not buying in. This is a combination of a coach who connects well with his players. That's something I will always give Rex Ryan credit for, is he is one of the better motivational coaches in the league. His job is on the line in Buffalo. The players had to spend 10 days, because they had a Thursday night game before this, hearing about it, so they had more time to prepare as well. But they had to spend all that time hearing about their coach, doubts about their team. This is a team that gets hyped up easily. And then on the other hand, you have the Arizona Cardinals, and you see this every year. You see a major upset from either an East Coast team going west or vice versa because, whether it be jet lag or something, we see it every year, and we see it with the Cardinals especially a lot. Carson Palmer has a tendency to choke in certain situations. And to travel basically to the opposite side of the country on a week like this and get caught off guard, it's a very loud stadium there in Buffalo. So sometimes you see West Coast teams lay an egg on the East Coast and vice versa. It happens every year. I'm going to say no, I'm not buying in on the Bills.
Well, you know, you bring up an interesting point, and I don't know if I'm buying into that because these are professionals. You know, okay, we're going to talk jet lag. We're going to use an excuse that they're tired. No, guys, this is the NFL. You're prepared. This is the only day of the week you prepare for is game day. You spend the entire off season getting ready for the season. How can you sit there and say that, you know, because they traveled and maybe they had No, I'm concerned about the Arizona Cardinals right now. I do not believe that they are the powerhouse that they were last year. And you know,
still the demons of that NFC title game against the Panthers, where
still,
they
still and with Green Bay not playing as well as they could be, you know, that I think that NFC's wide open right now.
Yeah, it could be. But, you know, I agree but disagree because they should be professional, they should be prepared, but it just feels like every year we see it. We see somebody go to somewhere where they should lose, they should win easily, and yet somehow the, you know, long distance, whatever, they just collapse. They can't do it. And so I'm wondering if this is just another one of those. The Cardinals, I think, are a big question mark as well, starting out 1-2.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I have more questions about the Cardinals right now than I do the Bills. I think the Bills had an out-of-body experience against the Cardinals, but I'm concerned if I'm a Cardinals fan.
All right, going on to another game in the NFC East. It was a lot of field goals. This might have been the game of the week right here, was the Redskins at the Giants. The Redskins having a lot of doubts. People were talking about how Kirk Cousins is losing the room, how there's been a lot of issues in the locker room going on in Washington after the first 2 weeks. Two bad losses, and then they come into the Meadowlands, take on the Giants, and have a pretty impressive game. So the Washington Redskins, I should say, are you buying in?
Not yet. I mean, you know, last year we watched this division just hand itself over week after week, right up until the end. It's tough to say who's who in this division right now. You know, for me, I still like what the Giants are about. I still think that they're, you know, working through the new coach thing. I think that they're going to improve throughout the season, and I think they have an opportunity to improve more throughout the season than the Redskins do. So I'm not buying into the Redskins yet.
I'm not buying into either of these teams. For start, okay, Odell Beckham Jr. got completely owned by Josh Norman again, and we started on the sidelines too, if you were catching this game. Odell basically punched the kicker's net, and it came back onto him. He was furious. He was screaming. He looked like a child, like he did last year against Josh Norman when he played him against the Panthers. And Eli Manning threw two horrendous interceptions at the end of the game, which caused them to lose. So this had a lot to do with Giants' mistakes. And Washington had some pretty cool plays. They had a punt block in this game, which I think is the play of the week, really. It was probably one of the best punt blocks ever seen, but at the same time, they were full of mistakes too. They folded a lot on defense, and this one, the one thing that made me scream at my TV, because I hate bad clock management. You can attest to this. I can go on forever about how Andy Reid could have been a Super Bowl champion several times over if he just knew how to handle a clock, because he can handle everything else. And Kirk Cousins, twice I've seen him as a terrible clock management quarterback, whether it was taking a knee last year when he was supposed to spike the ball, or this game where there's 6 seconds left, no timeouts, so he's trying to, you know, do a play before they have to kick a field goal, and instead of throwing the ball away, he starts running around, burns all the time, gets sacked. Bad clock management is going to make you lose games further on the road, Washington.
I feel your pain, Aaron Bolio, and I understand your concerns, and wise ones they are. But I will tell you this, that we are so spoiled as New England Patriots fans to have the coach of the century on our sidelines that, you know, I think we take a lot of this stuff for granted as New England fans, because we usually don't have conversations like this when it comes to the hometown team and Bill Belichick. But, you know, throughout the league, it doesn't matter where you are. Like you just said, the upside from the jet lag, we're also going to see a couple of these a year that are surprising too.
All right. Another team. There are five undefeated teams left. This is one of them, the Baltimore Ravens, who completely laid an egg last year, had all those terrible injuries, horrible, horrible losses to bad teams, even when they had their healthy players. They're 3-0 after a close win against the Jaguars in Jacksonville. 19-17 was the final, with a game-winning field goal in the final 2 minutes to seal the game.
Here's a team that I will buy into, because over the years, it's always been a tough opponent for the Patriots, especially as the year goes on, especially as we get near the playoffs. So, you know, it's a very – I think they were underachievers last year. So they're a team that I think we should watch out for, and I think that they're for real, no doubt about it.
I'm not totally sure on them yet, because on the one hand they aren't – on the one hand, I don't usually buy into them most years just because they do pretty bad until they make it to the playoffs, and that's when Flacco shines and that's when the team gets good. They're kind of like the Giants of the AFC. They're not great regular season teams, but then once they get in the playoffs, that's when they get good.
You don't want to see them in.
And they're 3-0 in the regular season right now. But the reason why I'm nervous about saying I'm buying in on them, they beat the Browns, the Jaguars, and the Bills. And they were not pretty wins. They were close, pretty rough wins. They were just squeaking by bad competition. So I'm going to put no, but I'm open for Baltimore to change my mind with a real opponent soon enough. But those wins did not impress me so far, just because of how
Well, then let me throw this at you. Just like anything else in the NFL, there are teams that should beat other teams, but once in a while, you'll see the slip-up during the course of the season. It's just as important, I believe, for these games that you should win. Maybe they're not pretty, but they're a W. And you can't fault a win is a win is a win.
And that's why I'm kind of taking a rain check on them. I don't want to say no. I'm leaning no just because the competition was bad. And it's not like they went in and blew these teams out like they probably could have. They were pretty narrow margins. They were losing to the Browns pretty badly in the first half. They had a comeback in that game. I don't doubt their mental toughness at all, but I need to see more is what I'll put for the Baltimore Ravens.
Well, how about the Ravens defense? I mean, the Ravens defense always shows up. Even since the retirement of Ray Lewis, they still have a staunch defense, especially with that pass rush. They can wreak havoc in the backfield. They can force interceptions. And, to me, they're still the same Ravens defense.
I'll give you that there. I'll give you so far this year anyway. They haven't looked like it the last couple of years, but they're starting to look like it now. But speaking of defense, best defense in the league last year was the Broncos, and they continue to dominate, a 29-17 win against the Bengals. They are one of the other five undefeated teams. Trevor Siemian had one of the best games a young quarterback has ever had, his third start, throwing for over 300 yards, several touchdowns. Broncos, buying in or no?
Actually watched this game, and I am buying in because, like Jacoby Brissett, there was some poise from the rookie quarterback in Denver, and that's a scary thing when you got a defense playing behind you like that. That offense seems to be running really well, even with the rookie there. And really, if you talk about shoes to fill, not as big a shoes as New England, in New England, I should say, Denver, not as quite big shoes to fill because Peyton Manning maybe not the quarterback that we saw for those many years, and Brock Osweiler really hadn't proven himself. So, that identity of that offense, I think, really has a lot of room to improve with this kid. And he's showing a lot of poise back there in the quarterback position.
I'm saying yes, 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 yes. This team is red hot. They have some of the most talented players in the league. I'm starting to wonder if they're similar to the Patriots in the regard. I'm not even sure if it's because Simeon's fantastic. I'm wondering if it's just the game plans they're putting out for him and the coaching. Because we saw Brock Osweiler make a lot of this offense last year, too, and we saw even a hurt Peyton Manning take advantage of a lot of these good receivers. I feel like this is one where if you can just plug in a competent quarterback, they're good. This is a good team around Siemian. He's proving to be all right. I'm wondering if they are planning on integrating Paxton Lynch, but I think if they do, he'll be fine as well. And the defense looks great. I don't think they look quite as good as they did last year, but they didn't have an offense last year, and the defense carried them. Now it looks like their defense is slightly not as good, and the offense is much, much better, so it almost completely evens out. This is going to be a dangerous team come playoff time.
I'm still going to say the defense is every bit as good because, they're still getting a lot of penetration in the backfield. They're still coming up with huge plays, huge turnovers, and to me, I don't think that defense is still getting enough credit because it sets the tone for that team. They run how that defense runs. They're able to get, off the field and keep opposing offenses off the field. It takes a lot of pressure off of that young quarterback and that offense. It allows them time to run the ball. It allows them the short passing game, the dink and dunk over the middle. They're not going to stretch the field. They're not going to throw 40-yard bombs and play Indianapolis-type offensive football. They need to grind it and pound it, and they need their defense to show up to keep that score where they can manage the game as you've seen in the first three games.
Well, if you've been seeing signs and people have been posting pretty much the same thing that you kept seeing at Thursday night, especially no Brady, no Jimmy, no problem. And
no
I've seen
Brady,
previous
no Jimmy,
weeks,
no problem.
No Brady, no Gronk, no problem. Well, Minnesota, no Teddy, no AP, no problem. They beat the defending NFC champions 22-10 in Carolina. They traveled to Carolina, dominated them on defense. Great game. Sam Bradford's 2-0 now with the Vikings. Vikings are now off to a 3-0 start. They are atop the NFC North, one of the other five undefeated teams. Are you buying into the Minnesota Vikings?
Absolutely. Absolutely, especially with a win, a big win like they had on Sunday. Quality team they're playing, and no Adrian Peterson speaks volumes for that team. Looking good on both sides of the ball. I'm buying into the Vikings.
I'm very interested to see if this is going to be a changing of the guard in the NFC North. I mean, the Packers are still playing at a high level, but their loss to Minnesota was bad, and their two wins against the Lions and the Jaguars were shaky, especially this one against the Lions. They dominated the Lions in the second half and then only won by a touchdown. They allowed the Lions to just come back in. That's very unlike the Packers, especially in Lambeau. And the Vikings, on the other hand, without their two best players, and this defense made the defending league MVP look like a rookie. They destroyed Cam Newton in that game. They got him for a safety, intercepted him, sacked him several times. The Panthers did not look like themselves. The Panthers are now have lost more games this year than they lost in the regular season last year with their two losses. So Panthers are a bit of a question mark, but the Vikings, that defense, especially for Minnesota, you know, they're missing their two best offensive pieces, but that defense taking down Aaron Rodgers and Cam Newton in back-to-back weeks.
Right now, looking like the most complete team out of the chute in the NFL, because as you said, not star-studded right now, having to work around some major injuries, and very New England Patriots-like, finding ways to win, filling those holes in those injured players, and using the system to beat very good quality teams.
So, and that's the thing too. I know it's only week three, but imagine what it'll be like next year when they figure their best players back. That defense. No, but the defense though. The other thing I'm going to mention. Not only did they stop Cam Newton and Aaron Rodgers, they held both those teams to under 20 points. This has been a very good start for Minnesota.
Huge statement by the Minnesota Vikings.
The Los Angeles Rams failed to score a touchdown the first 2 weeks of the year. Then they had a scoring frenzy against the Buccaneers in a high-scoring matchup that they won 37-32. They are now 2-1, and I believe they're actually atop the NFC West right now, tied with the Seahawks that are also 2-1. Are you buying into the L.A. Rams?
Praise the football gods. We can finally talk about a touchdown from the L.A. Rams since 1994. life is good in the NFL, but not good enough, I think, for the L.A. Rams for me to take them seriously. I think this team has a long way to go, a severe identity crisis still on offense, and I don't think they can score enough points to be a serious factor in that division.
I don't know what to really say about them because I think their defense is the best part of their game, but they gave up 32 points. But then on the other hand, their defense looked fantastic the first 2 weeks of the year, even in the blowout against the 49ers. This is tough, especially the other thing is we haven't seen Jared Goff yet. You know, they traded all the way up to get him number one overall. They've been trying to hold him back. And we've already seen some great play from rookies like Dak Prescott and Carson Wentz that both of them we'll be getting to in just a minute.
Sure.
But I think it's about time they let the rookie take the helm. And I think this team can become something. I'm not going to buy in yet, but we might readdress the Rams further down the road. I think they have a lot of potential.
It's still, you know, they still have a good defense. I mean, it isn't far removed from the great defense that they had just a few years ago. I mean, they're not missing that many components, and if they can find a way to find an identity on offense, you know, maybe they can turn things around, but right now I just don't see it.
Speaking of Carson Wentz, we're going to travel to the great state of Wentzylvania, as it's being called now.
You've been waiting to say that.
It's being called that now. It was a battle of Pennsylvania, Steelers at the Eagles. Steelers have not won a game in Philadelphia since 1965, fun fact. And the Steelers are going to have to wait another 8 years before they get that chance because they lost 34-3, got completely dominated by the Eagles in every facet of the game. Philadelphia Eagles are 3-0. 3-0 are the Eagles that we kept saying were going to be the worst thing ever. I apologize to Eagles so far. Are you buying in on Philadelphia Eagles?
Oh, absolutely, especially with the quarterback playing the way he is. Just making great decisions, veteran decisions back there, and they manhandled this Pittsburgh team. Who saw it coming? I did. Because this offense desperately needed a quarterback like they have found, and now this team has got an identity. I think they're putting it together, and no surprise for me in Pittsburgh.
If you had asked me this question last week, who I'm buying into, if I'm buying into the Eagles or not last week, I would have given you the same answer I gave with the Ravens. I haven't really seen them beat a good enough team to really lean one way or the other on that. And so this was the big proving mark for me. And I had a feeling Wentz was going to be good in this game because the Steelers' defense is their weakness right now. I completely underestimated the Eagles' defense in this game. We kept saying how we didn't think that, you know, who's going to stop the Pittsburgh offense? I thought this was going to be a massive high-scoring affair on both sides, and yet they were held to under a touchdown. No touchdowns in the game, just a field goal. They completely dominated Big Ben, who's hard to sack. There was a lot of sacks in that game. Wentz completely lit it up. I like this Eagles team, especially in a weak division like the NFC East. They should make the playoffs if they continue playing like this.
Surprise, surprise, surprise. The kid can read. I mean, if you look at some of the plays that he made throughout this game, going to his second and third and fourth reads, just I'm sure Pittsburgh obviously wasn't ready for what he brought.
And as I mentioned last week, I'm sure Browns fans were cringing the whole game.
How can you not? If you're a Browns fan, how can you not want to, like, jump off of a
And
Bruce
this is why I'm really excited for a game. I don't know what week it is. I know it's not going to be till, like, mid-October, late October. Eagles-Cowboys, that's going to be a game to watch this year because it's going to feature two very good young rookie quarterbacks. And that brings us to the other question. Dak Prescott and the Cowboys are now 2-1. They were could have easily been 3-0. I'm still holding that against Williams. Step out of bounds. I hate bad clock management.
Yeah, there's another
one
for you.
As I said, I hate bad clock management. If you could get me on the topic for a while, I usually beat my friend in Madden, actually, because we'll play Madden. He has no idea how to do clock management, and I win, and it hurts me. I don't feel good about the win because I know he's terrible at managing the clock. But anyway, the Cowboys, 2-1, 31-17 win over the Bears. They lit it up. Ezekiel Elliott and Dak Prescott and the whole gang, and unfortunately Dez Bryant looks like he's hurt. But this Dallas Cowboys team without Tony Romo already starting off good. Buying into the Cowboys or no?
I am buying into the Cowboys more now with Dak at quarterback than I would be if Tony Romo was back there, because they've had a hard time keeping Tony Romo upright throughout an entire season. And, you know, when they've gotten to a critical game in the playoffs, we've always heard about that key interception. I like the way the kid's playing. I really, really, really do.
He's been playing real confident. Took a, I'm not sure if he – did he throw an interception against the Bears? If he hadn't, he hasn't thrown one yet. He's already off to a great start at not throwing picks. His ball management skills have been very good the first 3 weeks. And this Cowboys team has a lot of talent on it. It's just been misused the last few years. 2014, that was what we saw. That was when we saw this Cowboys team at its best, with the offensive line performing, DeMarco Murray running it basically up
short.
Everybody, and Dez and Romo had a completely good connection. The defense was great. Unfortunately, last year, you know, they missed Romo and Dez was hurt. But even still, that Cowboys talent just kind of didn't live up to expectations, didn't live up to its potential. It looks like they're living up to it now. If they continue to live up to their potential, this should be a decent team, and that's why I'm excited to see when they play the Eagles, because that will I think the NFC East will go down between those two, and it will be quite a matchup to watch.
Oh, absolutely. I am buying into the Eagles. I'm buying into Dallas, and not for nothing, Dallas can still run the football. You know, they could run the football a couple of years ago, and they can still run the football now. And then you add a little bit of a mobile quarterback, and it's not what, you know, people that are preparing against Dallas are used to seeing. You know, Romo, more or less a pocket passer, may step up a little bit in the pocket, maybe a little bit mobile, scrambling a little bit, but he's not going to get outside like Dak is going right to right now. He's got legs. He's not afraid to take off, and it's a new component for that offense that I think adds a wrinkle that's going to make it difficult to defend against down the season.
All right, before we go to break, let's talk real, real quick about two of the big injuries that have happened this week. First one happened Thursday night. J.J. Watt was put on injured reserve. He's expected to be out for the season. If he even comes back at all, it'll probably be December. So the Texans will basically have to go through the long haul without their three-time defensive player of the year, J.J. He was already facing a back issue coming into the league. It looks like they pushed it, brought him back too early, and now he's out. What do you think about this injury, how it affects the Texans' season?
This is a deal-breaker for them. I mean, if he can't go, that defense takes a whole new change in its pass rush. The quarterback position there with Osweiler, I thought, was going to be better. I thought that was a team that just needed a quarterback to vastly improve. Haven't really seen that yet. So they still rely very, very heavily on that defense, and especially that pass rush headed up by J.J. Watt. This is a huge, huge deal breaker for them.
I think this changes everything, too. I mean, we talked about for the Patriots game, the blocking and how good it was against this team. That's what it's going to look like without J.J. Watt. I mean, without that penetration, this team is a very, very different team. Their corner play has never been really spectacular, and it's all basically lived and died by the pass rush with J.J. And without him, this defense is going to be on ice, and that's going to put a lot of pressure on Brock Osweiler, who took the extra money to go to Houston.
And still doesn't look like a comfortable quarterback in that offense.
He looked good, I think, last week, but he's still getting there. And I mean, he took a major step back Thursday. It's all going to live and die by them. And I mean, they're in a bad division, which is an advantage for them. It's going to, you know, they have to compete.
That's the only thing they have going for them.
They're basically their only competition is the Colts right now. But the Colts got their first win against San Diego Sunday night.
And the Colts always find a way to get in with a marginal record to begin
with.
Yeah,
and so they just need to outplay the Colts. I think that they should still end up in the playoffs, but it's not going to be a very easy run for them without their best player. And I think this other injury is probably going to hurt this team even more. Russell Wilson is going to be out for a minimum of 3 weeks, even though he's trying to push it. He re-injured that knee that got stepped on by Ndamukong Suh week one. Wilson's probably going to be out for this game upcoming against the Jets. Big loss, I think, for the Seahawks, but not too big if he's only going to be out for a little while.
Well, you know, I'm not as worried about this injury as I am for the Seahawks as I am the J.J. Watt injury for the Texans. And I'll tell you why. It's because he hasn't been operating on all cylinders for quite a while. That offense, to me, has been a little bit stymied. It's been a little bit stagnant. I don't think that they've put up the points that we've seen them put up in the past. It hasn't been an explosive performance by Russell Wilson in that offense. So, you know, maybe getting some fresh legs back there might even help. And when you have a coach like Pete Carroll in a system like they have, I think there's a good opportunity for the plug-in situation like you see here in New England. Granted, Russell Wilson has the skill set of very few quarterbacks, being mobile, being able to throw on the run. But again, hasn't been healthy. I don't think it's as big an injury as it is for
now
them.
Without Marshawn Lynch, without the offensive line, it's very, very tough to compare this Seahawks team to the one 2013 that won the Super Bowl. But Russell Wilson was a second-year quarterback. Actually, let's go back. Let's go back a year before the Super Bowl win. We'll go to his rookie year. He was just supposed to be a game manager, and the defense was supposed to win games for him, and that's what they did. And unfortunately, they don't have the running back to support it. But if this defense is as good as it's supposed to be, it should be able to at least support the weight until Wilson gets back. And their rookie didn't look too bad. The rookies this season have been pretty good, and their rookie quarterback that stepped in for them didn't look too bad. If they can just have that rookie manage the game, the Seahawks should be able to float water until
good,
he comes
good
back.
Good point on Marshawn Lynch, too. I mean,
but it's a good division. That's the opposite of the Texans. They've got the Cardinals, and the Rams are the best team in that division right now, record-wise. So you don't want to lose too many games because you don't want to fall back on the Cardinals especially.
Very true. All right, guys, we're going to step out. When we come back, we've got a lot more, including the breakdown of Week 4 coming up in the NFL. You're watching Sports Talk here on Leominster TV.
Here's a special message for all you ladies out there. I know you have nothing on except for Jeff in the morning.
Good God!
Hey, Jeff, your wife's not going to get pissed about this, is she? All right, that's good to hear. I've been joining Jeff and me, Rich the Clausier, right here on LTV.
Good morning, Leominster.
Good morning.
Good morning, Leominster. Someone left the letter she wrote me on the radio.
It's early enough in the day. Words are coming out of my mouth. At some point, I'm going to offend somebody. Yay, Steve Buscemi. I'm getting my banana.
Well, isn't there like a comet headed for the sun?
No, you don't have to spend time with him just as long as you put on that deal. What the frick is wrong?
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey.
Yeah, what?
We want banana time.
Eat your freaking vegetables, okay? Eat your vegetables.
Good.
Just shut up if I want to go hunting, all right?
Let the freaking world go to hell in a handbag.
Sorry, I've never understood a bidet.
Oh, it's so fresh in here.
Yes, it smells like Febreze and dead body.
Huh? You've ever been to City Hall, and you must experience the elevator.
Does anyone have a real trampoline anywhere?
Hey,
I like to have options with my toilet paper. Hey,
for some reason, my brain isn't working right today.
I don't mind a little bit of hair care product.
You should use Brill creams.
Next year, we are going to do a documentary on how the Chinese food places prepare for New Year's Eve.
Why? Wait, you want to go smell them or something?
And smelling it.
Is it like vinegar?
No, it was like, it was almost like mimeographic.
Keep yourself clean. Clean up after yourself.
These were the days of right God.
Do you know what I mean?
And it's like we're on a different level today. It's like things just aren't happening.
I don't know whether I'd want to actually be trapped in a bottle such as that. Where do you go to the bathroom?
Yeah, good point.
Jack, you seem to have Rice Krispies, but that's okay. Let me hear you speak.
Hey, have you noticed a big zit growing on the tip of my nose?
I hadn't quite yet.
I have a really important question, so I'm really sorry, Jack, but this is huge. I got a huge question, and it has to do with men's underwear.
Valderie, Valdera, Valderie, bring it over here.
All right, to my opinion.
You going to bother me about a steak?
Stop quoting movies.
You're so vain. I bet you think this song is about you.
It was just a big soup of naked people in this, like, infinity pool at this wedding in Mexico.
I like your new rooster. Now, does your new rooster's head come off?
Really? We're doing a show here.
Yeah, we are doing a show.
Hey, we're doing a show.
A little respect.
Shut your mouth. Come on.
Respect.
Yeah. Tomorrow with more talk about doe urine. Bye.
Thanks.
Welcome back to Sports Talk on Leominster Television. And to recap last week's picks, it looks like the old man is taking another lead on you. It's back and forth this season, unlike last season.
I talked myself out of picking the Rams, and I should have picked the Rams. It would have narrowed it. We would have been tied for this week, but what can you do? All right. Well,
it's a long season.
We got to get through this quick. I want to start real quick. I just want to bring this in. You can turn my
get there Friday and have a pretty normal Friday.
Julian, this is Walt Patalski from the Buffalo News.
If you were to run into a kicking net, would the kicking net win or would you win?
All right, you can turn that down. That there was Rex Ryan. He's trying to basically pretend to be a reporter named Walt Polinski on a Buffalo Bills conference call where he's asking Julian Edelman if he's going to play quarterback. I'm not amused anymore.
No.
This used to be funny years ago, but you know what happened? You started losing, Rex. You started losing games. You lost the room. The character is gone. The guy that is Rex Ryan is gone. The idea of you pretending to be a media figure, that's funny to a point, but when you haven't beaten the Patriots in forever, when it's just it's lost its touch.
I think there should be a little less swagger from Rex and a little more humble from Rex.
And if he hadn't beaten the Arizona Cardinals, he would have kept his mouth shut because his job would still be in the line. And that's why, for our pick segment, I'm picking the Patriots to beat the Bills this week.
Yep.
I expect him to bring that swagger in. I think this will be a pretty close game still, but I don't like the Bills pretty much in most matchups the rest of the year. Your pick, Jeff?
Very easy pick for me. Pats big over the Bills.
All right. Thursday night football, Dolphins at Bengals.
I'm going to take the Bengals in this one.
I think it'd be crazy not to. The Dolphins almost choked away a game to Cleveland.
Yeah.
Colts at Jaguars in London.
Colts at Jaguars in London. I'm going to take the Colts.
I'm going to hold out one last reserve for the Jaguars with their offense.
Well, thank you for doing that.
For their offense playing against the Colts. Poor defense, I think, should at least be able to get some kind of points, right?
It could be.
Titans at Texans.
I'm going to take the Texans. Although no J.J. Watt, I think at home coming off the loss of the Patriots, I like the Texans.
I do, too. Browns at Redskins. Unfortunately, RG3 won't be there for his homecoming.
Yeah, Browns against anybody. You just might as well stymie up for the other guy.
Yeah, I'm pretty much on the same. Seahawks at Jets. Keep in mind, Russell Wilson might not be playing that game.
Yeah, you know, I like the Jets in this game. Maybe a little upset in the mix there. Jets playing well. I'll take the Jets.
I'll take the Seahawks, even without Wilson.
Okay.
I'll take it. Panthers at Falcons.
Panthers at Falcons. I'm going to take Carolina in that one.
I'm going to take Carolina, too, even though the Falcons have a better record, better start. I think Carolina's going to put Atlanta in its place. Raiders at Ravens.
That's going to be a tough game to pick, I'll tell you. Probably the toughest game of the week to pick. At Ravens, I'll take the Ravens at home.
I'm going to take the Oakland Raiders.
The Raiders.
Lions at Bears.
I'm going to take the Lions all day long, especially after the offensive performance last week.
Yeah, I'm pretty much with you on that. The Bears have been pretty poor, you know, with Brian Hoyer and now and such. Broncos will be going on the road to take on the Buccaneers.
Doesn't matter. That defense is too much for anybody. I don't see anybody stopping them anytime soon. I'm taking the Broncos.
I'm, like, tempted to pick the Bucs for an upset just because I think Jameis Winston's a good quarterback. But the way they performed against the Cardinals, the way their defense couldn't stop the Rams, and the way how I picked them and they ended up failing me worked last week. I'm going to pick Denver and be safe about this.
All right.
Rams at Cardinals.
Boy, you know, it depends which team shows up for the Cardinals. I mean, it should be an easy pick, but it's really not. I'm hoping that they turn it around and get it back on track this week. I'll take the Cardinals at home.
I'm going to take the Rams. Bit of an upset. Rams always play the Cardinals good. Cardinals, I think, might be a bit of embarrassed last week, but you know what? I paid for it by not picking the Rams. I'm going to pick the Rams again this week.
Wow. Okay.
All right. Saints at Chargers.
Yeah, I'm liking the way the Saints are playing, although they couldn't put it together in the second half against Atlanta. Off to a dismal start. Chargers putting up big points at home. I like the Chargers in this game.
I'm going to go NOLA. I have not been too impressed with the way the Chargers played last week. The Saints' offense has at least been pretty good for them so far this year. I think we're going to have a good high-scoring battle between the master and the apprentice, Drew Brees.
Yeah, Chargers are another team that you just don't know who's going to show up.
Drew Brees and Phillip Rivers. Phillip Rivers, you know, was the former backup of Drew Brees there in San Diego, so that's always an element to look at. This was probably one of the best rivalries of the late 80s and early 90s. Now it's kind of garbage. Mm. That would be Dallas and San Francisco. This would be Dallas at San Francisco, I should say.
Yeah, I'm taking the Cowboys on the road. I think they're playing very, very well, and the 49ers are not.
Yeah, I'm wondering if Colin Kaepernick will end up getting some game time soon enough, because the Blaine Gabbert experiment is not working in Chip Kelly's offense so far. I don't see why he's still fighting it, especially when I think Kaepernick would work better in a Chip Kelly system. I don't know why. They're still going with Gabbert, but I'm going to switch my pick to Dallas here.
Okay.
Sunday Night Football, Kansas City Chiefs at Pittsburgh Steelers. This might be your game of the week, people.
I believe so. I think, you know, the Steelers got it handed to them last week, and they bounce back against the Chiefs at home. I don't think so. I think the Chiefs are going to win on the road. I think the Chiefs have the momentum going right now and a big win. Pittsburgh, after this game, is going to be looking for some answers.
Pittsburgh is full of, you know, the resilient type of people, a resilient team, great players. Kansas City's very good as well. I'm going to go with the Pittsburgh Steelers at home.
All right.
And final game, Monday Night Football, New York Giants at Minnesota Vikings.
I like the Minnesota Vikings in this game just because they're at home. The time of year, you know, I still think, although no Adrian Peterson, the Vikings right now are a complete team and finding ways to win despite injuries. I like the Vikings.
I picked against the Vikings the last 2 weeks, and I will continue to pick against them until they prove me otherwise that it's a bad idea.
There you go.
They've looked great these first 3 weeks, even without some of their best players, especially the defense. We're going to keep going with that. And where are we at with time?
Now, very, very interesting week here in the NFL coming up, and a great week that we had as well.
We actually just slammed through this pretty quickly, so I'm going to spend the last second asking you a quick baseball question.
Baseball, okay.
It's going to be kind of interesting.
Baseball.
So the Cleveland Indians this week just lost their ace pitcher, so now they're down three pitchers going into the playoffs. And we know the Red Sox have clinched the playoff berth as of right now. They're still – we're going to see if they clinch the division. They should. And now they're competing for that number one spot against Texas. With the Indians down three pitchers, should they go for home field advantage and risk playing a team like the Blue Jays or the Tigers that they are more likely to lose to? Or should they try and stay at the second seed and try and take on the Indians for a safer bet?
I think you take a page out of the New England Patriots playbook, and you don't take your foot off the accelerator for any reason at all. You know, momentum, I think, is the biggest factor this time of year when it comes to playoff baseball. You've played 162 games to decide who's where, and, you know, how many wild card teams have we seen come out of nowhere and win World Series? So I like the idea of keeping the momentum going. I like the idea of having series at home. Although I don't think it matters as much in a seven-game series as it does, you know, for football where it's any given Sunday, I'd like to see him put the pedal down and take it off.
I think they should do that, too, just because, you know, I think a lot of people are saying, you know, Texas has had their number the last few years. You don't want to play Texas in the playoffs. I'm like, well, look, Texas will end up playing the Indians if you take the number one spot. So, and if you believe Texas is going to win, then you're going to play Texas either in the ALDS or the ALCS. You know, well, it doesn't matter. So I would just say go for it all, you know, because you're going to have to play the best team eventually.
Sure.
If you're going to win the World Series, that's
what's
going to happen.
And the best team at that time is going to be on the field, whether it's, you know, whoever won the division or who was ever hot lately.
And what are you going to do then? Hope the Cubs don't make it? Because the Cubs right now are the hottest team in baseball. So I would say go for it all. You know, if you lose to the best team, then you didn't deserve to be there. You know, that's how the playoffs works.
This is not the time of year to dial it down for any reason. I think, you know, you're playing at your highest level. You want to continue to improve every week because every single game, every single series, the stakes get higher. You know, everybody turns it up a notch, and you've got to continue that at this time of year.
All right. Well, baseball regular season ends this weekend, so I'm sure next week we'll be able to talk a little playoff baseball when you host the show. So
fun time of year. Fun time of year.
I'm going to say that's probably going to be it for us this week then.
All right. And, again, thank you all for joining us, and we're going to keep an eye on Big Poppy and his last tour through New York as well and last playoff tour with the Boston Red Sox. We're going to keep you interested also in up to date on all of the football scores from around the league, breaking down the upcoming games. We want to thank you all for joining us. We want to thank everybody here at the station and the crew. And until next week, we'll see you then.